I entered football about age five. Very common story. I followed my older brother to football and never really looked back, to be honest. Mum made me play 1 year under eights netball. That was just to see if I liked it. I also used to do athletics as well, so I gave that up to do football full time at age 12, 13. So, yeah, never looked back. I absolutely loved it. I was always the only girl in the team, and not just the only girl on the team, the only girl in my club, the only girl in the competition, and I could go as far to say the only girl playing in Campbelltown, outside of maybe Heather Garriock, who was playing at the time. And we were the two girls that were kicking around, and look, to be honest, I think I'm part of the 1%ers that anything that would have been put in front of me, I would have overcome to play for my country and or at least play at an elite level. But I think that the barriers that are there for young girls, we've got to do some work on to make sure that all young girls can play and not, you know, and play just for fun as well. So it took me a while to get to the national team, actually. I debuted at 21, but I actually I made the team at age 15. I made the squad at age 15 and then did my ACL, ruptured my ACL, and ended up doing that three more times before kind of taking an extended period away. So I'd had three knee reconstructions by age 18. Missed the 2000 Olympics, 2003 World Cup because of it. Then went on to debut at 21, which is actually quite late, after a bit of time off, and really didn't have a lot of faith in my knee throughout my entire career, to be honest, because once you've had that many kind of major injuries, you lose a lot of faith in your body. But the beauty of that is that I played every single match, honestly, as it was my last. And so when I did come time to retire in 2012, a good 8-9 years playing for my country, when surgeons told me I should stop running, to get 8 years with the national team, it was all kind of bonus years. So I look back at it and wouldn't change a thing. Yeah, there's plenty of key moments. I mean, when you're a Matilda for 8-9 years, particularly at a moment in time where there's a lot of change happening. I mean, there's so much change happening now. When you look at the 40-year history of the Matildas, it was very slow, and I would even call it incremental up until the 2000s. And then it was, building out conditions like Wi-Fi and laundry for players, having that covered, beyond the days of sewing patches on shirts. And so I come through a very, I think, important period, 2007 and 2010, when we negotiated our first CBA with the Football Federation. And I was actually on the players' executive at the time, and I've always had a passion for improving things and I think asking the right questions, because I'd always thought that the Matildas had the potential to be exactly who they are today and exactly who they showed us to be in 2023. And the great thing is, I think they can go a lot higher than where they are on and off the pitch with that success. 2010, we won the Asian Cup. I actually came home from the airport for some reason thinking that there were going to be hundreds of cameras and thankfully our parents turned up and families, because that's all that was there to greet us on the other side. Kind of hadn't realised at the time how big that moment was. That was really Australia's first international silverware, and we've only done it once since. Really hard to win the Asian Cup. I mean, the Matildas, the squad's tried it twice since, and it's just so difficult because of the talent. But I remember coming back and being really disappointed that the results hadn't translated into increased investment or the media and exposure that the team I thought deserved at the time. And so I moved into the Federation in 2012 and kind of haven't looked back. I've had various roles, but been involved in the recent collective bargaining agreements, and it's kind of going full circle as a player to executive and being involved on both sides of the table, if you will. I think gives me pretty unique kind of insights into putting the player first, particularly around all decisions, but also thinking holistically about decisions and thinking about all stakeholders when you're making them. Yeah, well, the Legacy 23 plan, it was, we kicked that off in 2021. It was obviously part of our bid. to win the rights to host from FIFA. In 2020, when we won the rights to host, we started to socialise that with our stakeholders to make sure that we were thinking more holistically about how we wanted to leverage the event. And I think in a short summary, it's really delivering economic and social change as a result of hosting. It was never just about hosting the event for us with New Zealand. And so we established that plan, and you know, over a good 3 years, really proud to say that we'd unlocked over $357 million in funding for football as a result of hosting. And it's not just the investment. I think, you know, with what we did with the Matildas on the pitch, we had them at the centre and heart of everything that we did for 3 years. And we really, I guess, focused in on how we can improve, or how we can actually cascade all the change we'd made at a Matildas level. What does equal opportunity look like for a young girl at a community level? And so there's a lot of levers you need to pull and barriers that you need to provide solutions for, to make sure that, one, we're increasing the talent pool, but also increasing the number of girls playing through retention. A lot of work to do, and we found that our community facilities are just not up to scratch for women and girls for a long time. They've been designed by men for men, and we have to improve these standards. So we've got a long way to go, but I'm pretty happy to say that, you know, through that 3 years of foundational building, we're excited to see numbers already up in the build-up to our registration window early next year. Super exciting, because we know that the demand's there. We feel like we've done the work. We've unlocked the investment to really start to see that impact. And I really don't think that we'll be able to fully measure the impact until a couple of years from now. And that's why we need to start looking at hosting, you know, other events in the future, like the Women's World Cup. Within the Legacy 23 plan, there are five key pillars, and one of them is high performance. And you know, it's really centred around making sure that we're building a legacy beyond this current Matildas squad. And within all of that, we had a very solid strategy around making sure that they ran deep in this tournament. We had a very solid on-field strategy in terms of all the learnings that have been shared through this performance gap report in 2020, highlighted that we weren't playing enough highly ranked opposition. We weren't playing enough European opposition. And we absolutely weren't building enough squad depth. And as you could see throughout 2023, we were able to have a solid squad of 23. But there's a team that exists beyond that. And we also had this unique opportunity to appoint a coach that was on board with the strategy. He did a fantastic job at driving that strategy in, you know, in his own way. And I think that it was a very tough 3 years for the team. We had to build the fandom around them, and you know, if you turn up to a Matildas match now, you wouldn't know if they've won or lost at the end of the game, because there's still 30 deep, you know, lines of young kids, families waiting to get a glimpse of their heroes. And so we had to build the brand of the Matildas, and also have a solid focus on their on-field strategy to make sure that all the other parts would fall into place, because unless we have a visibly strong CommBank Matildas, it's going to be awfully hard for us to drive interest at a grassroots level. And so we had these interconnected pillars. The legacy strategy still lives on. As I said, we're going to measure the impact of all of these programs and initiatives for the next couple of years through the foundations we built over the past 3 years. But ultimately, we've got a long way to go with community facilities. Only 40% of our community facilities are considered inclusive for girls. And we were able to inspire and unlock a $200 million fund through the federal government during the World Cup. You're inspired by the CommBank Matildas, and we need to really make sure that our clubs are at the forefront of, you know, securing some of those funds, because we are the biggest club-based sport here in Australia, which means that we have the greatest reach, but we also have the greatest challenges because of the sheer number of clubs that we have. So we have to unlock further funding, but also continue to make sure that we educate our clubs around being inclusive for women and girls. That's one thing. We're still going to keep building on the success of the Matildas through this CommBank Growing Football Fund. We're going to make sure that we start to accelerate progress, particularly around female coaches. We really need more female coaches in the game, and not just that, we need to reshape the way that coaching has been delivered for women and girls. And so we've got an injection of funds from CommBank that is going to fast track that work. I think we'll be talking about this event for decades. We have 2032 Olympics coming up, which is one of the biggest events in the world. And for us, I think something that we were very pleased about as hosts of the FIFA Women's World Cup 2023, co-hosts with New Zealand, is that the way in which Australia got around, whether it be through, you know, tickets, merchandise, or broadcast or attendance. I mean, it was one of the most commercial World Cups in the history of Women's World Cups, and for us, we were very pleased that off the back of hosting the 2015 Asian Cup, multicultural Australia got engaged, and you know, at one point when the semi for England v Australia was on, you know, we had 11.2 million people as a total reach watching just on Network 7, and that doesn't capture Optus's numbers, and it doesn't capture, you know, the multiple stadiums nationally that were literally turning on screens so strangers could watch a match that was on screen. These are just unheard of, but we think that we've unlocked something here in Australia. The impact that has on young children is that they can dream, you know, they can dream to play in a major tournament, or they can dream and also see themselves. Definitely, in particular, obviously the major tournaments that have been put on over the years, I can see that we're starting to build in terms of how we commercialise these events, but also the development of football across the Asia region is definitely progressing at a faster rate, whether it be through the AFC club licensing, something that I think is a fantastic initiative that really allows clubs to benchmark themselves and you know, use as a tool to be able to improve in really key areas, whether it be through technical or just grassroots development. And football is being progressed at a very quick rate, particularly in Europe. And you know, some of the other confederations are also struggling to keep up with the pace of Europe. But I think with some of the measures, particularly around the AFC Women's Champion League, all of these levers that the AFC are now pulling, plus, you know, we've got the Asian Cup. I think that is really, the Women's Asian Cup, I think, can be the centrepiece of what we all build around here in Asia. And I'm very excited for the next edition. And the AFC Women's Champions League is right at the heart of the change. When you think about what the Champions League has been like for, whether it be, you know, Europe in particular, I think it's the one big reason that big players go to some of the big clubs in Europe is because they get to play Champions League. And I'm very excited about what that means for Asia. Obviously we've had pilot programs in the past, but now we're talking about a continuation of that, but also something that clubs in this region can strive for. Coupling that with club licensing, I think that, you know, driving higher standards for clubs at a rate that works for all of Asia is really important. There are many countries that are a little bit further behind in terms of development, but we really need to start thinking about how we kind of lift the standards of everybody, whilst also creating a platform for the stronger nations to be able to compete. So I'm very excited about what the AFC Women's Champions League will do for football in Asia. Do it. It's, look, I think the things that I love about football is the friendships that I've built over years. And you know, some of my closest friends today are the friends that I travelled the world with, playing for my country. And you know, you go through the highs and lows with each other. But I think if you're going to work in football, definitely, particularly in women's football, some days are harder than others. I think it's about surrounding yourself with like-minded people who share your vision for the game, because I mean, the times that it's tough, I mean, social change is difficult. But I think we're getting in a really great space now. But I think surround yourself with good people and just make sure that you stop to smell the roses and enjoy yourself. I think that Asia can be a big player. We're already starting to see that shift in men's football, where we're playing a bigger role in in club football, whether it be in the Middle East, and I think that women's football is only going to follow the same trajectory as the men's. And you know, I think we've got a really good opportunity with some of the biggest footballing nations like Japan, and we can actually play a leading role. And as I said, with the changes that the AFC are making, particularly around the AFC Women's Champions League and also the club licensing, they're the kind of levers we need to pull to stay in touch with Europe, but also be globally competitive. And you know, we already seen the last World Cup with how well a lot of the lower ranked Asian nations played in their first. We had two debutantes and they played fantastically. So more exposure to major tournaments is a very good thing. And so, you know, more opportunities to play in tournaments like the Asian Cup, the AFC Asian Cup, and you know, everything else that qualifiers that sit underpin that are crucially important to bringing Asia together and also making sure that we fast track our development. I think I'm obviously not the first woman to work in football, but I stand on the shoulders of many that have come before me. And I work with an amazing group of women on the AFC, a Women's Football Committee, and so I think that I hope that our presence and leadership that we provide in football is opening paths for other young women to not only think that they can work in football, but also believe they belong there. And I hope that, you know, the visibility of myself and all my colleagues on the AFC Women's Committee and the work that we do to lead the game really opens pathways and, you know, builds the confidence of young women looking to work in football.